So we pulled over to the side of West Virginia Route 33 in the Monongahela Forest, where the river curved and a large cliff came up. And I got out of the car, picked up my bag of picnic stuff, and went over to my girlfriend's store and helped her out. And as she got out, I handed her a hat with a large copper headlamp on it. And she looked at the hat. She looked behind me at the cliff with the cave in it and looked back at me and said, "You've done this before, right?" What happened was I went up far away to college in West Virginia because I really wanted to have experiences. And I wanted to learn, of course, and have fun. And I knew that somewhere along the line, I might meet a wonderful woman. And that I wanted to meet somebody who we'd be compatible with, who would be able to talk with, who would have a sense of adventure, and that was really important. So I was dating this one woman, and she was with me all the time, and we did lots of things, and she listened to my stories, laughed at my jokes. But one Saturday I said, you know, I was gonna go away for the weekend and in search of adventure. And she said, "Well, can't I come?" So there we were. So I was lighting the carbide gas lantern that we used, and those caves are so, so dark that you can't see your hand in front of your face. And so we were walking in to this big opening, and then soon we were stooping through the opening, and then pretty soon we were crawling, and then we were belly crawling. And then when we finally got in, it opened up in this big cavernous room that was just beautiful. And we walked into it, it was breathtaking. It was just flowstone, limestone white, and stalactites and stalagmites. It was so big, you couldn't see the other side with the lights, but we could hear a river. So we went to the far side, saw the river, and we followed the river up into a tunnel where the walls got closer and closer, but there was a shelf that had been eaten out by the water. And so we were walking up on the shelf, and then the shelf got smaller and smaller. We had to jump to the other side. And then we walked up and the shelf got smaller and smaller, and we jumped to the other side. We did this for a while until we got up to where the river shot out of a crack in the wall and then went down this slot canyon. And we had our story. We had our adventure. It was so cool. So we turned and we started walking back, and I heard this pop. And I looked at her hat, and there were extra flames coming from the carbide light. And I heard pop, and I said, "Oh my gosh." So I hit mine and hers on the ground, and the hats were on fire on the floor of the cave. And I'm looking at them, what to do. And I had this awful pressure on my arm. And I looked over, and my girlfriend was looking down the long chasm with the river at our long black shadows that were getting longer as the fire got smaller. So I quickly grabbed into the bag, pulled out two flashlights, and I gave her a flash, and we turned them on, and they were kind of yellowish. And we took a couple steps, and hers flickered and went out. And so quickly I went into the bag with mine before it went out and got two candles. And we lit the candles. And I'll tell you, when you're looking at a single flame under miles of rock and hours to daylight, it's very lonely. And we walked down the river on the shelf, hiding our candle from the wind, hearing the black water rushing behind us and not being able to see it. And then I jumped across to the next shelf, and the candle went out. And there I am, pressed against the wall, trying to light a candle in absolute darkness. And then I got her across. And now I don't understand why, but she was making this kind of weird staccato laugh thing. It was very annoying. We eventually did get to the big room, at which point I thought everything was great. And we got to the far wall in the big room, and then I knew I had real problems. There wasn't the one crawlway we came in. There were dozens of crawlways. At this point, my girlfriend, she wasn't talking. She looked frozen. She was just standing there. So I sat her down on the ground with her candle, said, "Stay here." I'll find it. And I tried the first one, and it was too steep. The next one, it was too wet. The next one was too rocky. These weren't it. I was like, what am I going to do? The next one, I found one that was going up and up. And I called back, reassuringly, I hope. I think this one's going to be another way out. Pretty soon, I saw light. And I said, I see light. I see light. It's going to be okay. And it came out into another room. And I saw a caver sitting on the floor. And I said, oh, I'm so glad to find you. We're lost. And then I realized the caver was sobbing, crying. The caver was my girlfriend. The cave tunnel had reached around under the mountain and come back to the same room. In horror, I turned and I looked at the wall where they all were, and I realized I'd tried them all. So I walked up slowly and I held the candle up and went back and forth, and I could see a shadow moving slightly differently that I hadn't seen before. And I walked over and there was a rock that was hiding the well-worn pathway out. We had walked into this beautiful, breathtaking, and not looked back. So on the ride back to campus, she didn't talk to me. In fact, I never saw her again. I heard she transferred to another college. But I can say that even though she failed the compatibility test, and although I knew my hopes, desires, and dreams, I realized I also failed. I failed to see with the eyes of my heart. With the eyes of my heart, her soul's hopes, dreams, desires, and fears.